Healing Your Back of Chronic Pain, Reversing Habitual Responses. Written by Dr. Christopher Maloney, ND. Narrated by Christopher Maloney. Dedication for all those patients who taught me about their pain. May you all be well, and thank you. Acknowledgements. I want to thank the tireless researchers who provide us with answers about our bodies. Thank you to Joe, my proofreader, business partner, and friend. Thank you to R, A, E, G, and my other patients who have read and commented on the book. I do listen and try to improve. To my family, my eternal thanks for bearing with me as I pore over medical texts. To my colleagues and teachers, you have taught me more than I can remember. And thank you, dear reader, for taking the time to care enough about your own back. Warning. This book is for informational purposes and is not intended as a substitute for the medical advice of a physician. The reader should consult a physician if they have any symptoms that may require diagnosis or medical attention. Be wise and take care of yourselves. Chapter 1. Why This Book? Congratulations on starting your journey away from chronic pain. Every journey begins with a single step, and you've taken that step by looking for this book and finding it. If you have chronic back pain, then this book is for you. It may help when nothing else has. To be clear, nothing in this book replaces common sense. If you are in a car accident, please do not haul this book out of the crushed glove compartment and expect it to replace surgery. Get yourself patched up and read this book only after your surgeons have stabilized your spine. But if you've had multiple surgeries without success, then this book may be more helpful than one more surgery. Most surgeons know there is a decreasing return after initial surgeries and will do additional surgeries reluctantly. Many books on back pain focus entirely on exercise routines, so I assume you have access to those and may have tried some already. If you haven't, some of you may benefit from learning how to stretch the muscles of the back. Instead of another physical treatment or set of exercises, we will talk in this book about habitual responses in the back. We will look at how habitual responses can trigger chronic muscle tension in the back, leading to pain. These responses may be to a physical cause, but they may also be generated by an emotional state or even by mental stress that leads to physical tension in the back. By helping you recognize these responses, we may completely resolve chronic back pain that has not been helped by other treatments. We're talking specifically about back pain that has continued despite drugs and treatment, especially if you have more pain when you're stressed. If you've read psychology books on letting go of stress, you may have tried to resolve your pain by telling yourself it is strictly mental. One famous back doctor has had some success with this mental model, but the mental model denies the reality that many pains worsened by stress also have physical triggers that are not under our conscious control. The conscious mind can work through the stresses you are aware of, releasing that tension. But unconscious, habitual stress may escape notice or be re-triggered by movement, by familiar situations, or by simply having a similar emotional feeling. For those of you who have doubts that anything will help your chronic back pain, let me tell you a story. When she was young, Jane, not her real name, was in a terrible car accident. After mostly healing from the accident, Jane found herself still suffering with chronic back pain. It wasn't quite bad enough for additional surgery, so she was sent out from the hospital with debilitating, agonizing pain. By the time she found me, 20 years later, she'd been to every back specialist under the sun and had nothing to show for it except an addiction to painkillers. The painkillers did help Jane with her pain, but they weren't enough. She was on 8 Oxycontin a day, the maximum her doctor would prescribe. Despite the drugs, she lived her life in a fog of pain. Before the accident, Jane had been thinking about college, maybe even becoming a doctor. But after the accident, she couldn't focus. She had dropped out of college, married, and had children. So to the outside world, she was coping with her pain. But every day, she had to make a list of the things she was supposed to do, double-checked that she's turned off the stove, and live in constant fear that she might forget to pick up one of her kids from school. When I saw Jane, she was at the end of her rope. Conventional options had been exhausted long ago. She had heard about me from another patient, but was highly skeptical that anything we could do would help her. I looked at her lab reports, x-rays, and CT scan. Nothing in them showed any reason for her pain. Certainly nothing to justify a surgery. So then I did something that most of her doctors had not done. I examined her back in detail with my hands. Jane's whole back was a board, no flexibility anywhere. Imagine tensing your entire back, every muscle, and holding that tension all day and all night. That was her normal back tension. Of course that would hurt. Part of her pain was simply from muscle exhaustion. As the back muscles tire, they switch from using oxygen to help burn sugar for energy to burning sugar without oxygen. Like a fire in the fireplace, the lack of oxygen means that the muscles burn less efficiently, and that causes them to build up acid. The acid hurts if there's too much of it in the muscle. The pain sensation you get in your arm from trying to hold a weight up for too long is from too much acid, metabolic acidosis. Jane's entire back, under constant tension, burned like that all the time. As we worked on Jane's back together, she gradually released. Just feeling the release was enough to bring some tears of relief. Many of my patients no longer believe any relief is possible, so it can be emotional to hope for improvement again. After several visits, the back was mostly relaxed. We found one bone in the middle of her back that would pop out of place. It would happen every time she lifted anything or every time she felt stressed about her children. When her back went out of place, her muscles would spasm over the entire back to protect it from further damage, just as they had after the original car accident so many years before. It was the root cause of the pain. Unraveling Jane's specific pain and its triggers was the curative treatment, though it took some time to figure out everything that triggered her. After our work together, she was able to decrease her Oxycontin doses and eventually went off all medication. I haven't seen her in some years now. At times her pain returns, but she's able to deal with it without drugs. Her life didn't become perfect, but she doesn't have to have the pain she had before. By working with her body rather than trying to ignore it, she has found a path to relief. Many doctors who work with chronic pain want to see you all the time. They need to treat you multiple times a week forever for the treatment to work. My best patients are those who I see for a period of months who learn how to heal themselves. I don't need to see them again for years at a time because they're able to resolve their own pain. These are determined people who've continued to pursue their paths to health long after others would have accepted pain as a daily companion. Together we've worked to find what works for them on a daily basis. I hope to give you the tools we've developed together to help you understand and heal your pain. Chapter 2. Born to Pain. Just now, as I tilted myself in my chair, I felt three different pops in my upper back. It's not uncommon for me to need to shift myself to let go of tension and pain a dozen or more times a day. When I was 12, an enterprising chiropractor examined me and found a gold mine. My left side is shorter than my right, and my torso shows lowered ribs on the left side. He sold me a lift for my left foot and prescribed weekly treatments for the rest of my life. If that wasn't enough, I also had lordosis, an overly curved lower spine. My chiropractor told me it was due to weak stomach muscles, leading to hundreds of sweaty sit-ups for years afterwards. Add to that a compressed spinal fracture from high school, and there's no reason to think I wouldn't live my life in pain or sucking down painkillers. But I don't. As I'm writing, I don't experience pain. It isn't because of my perpetually ongoing treatments. Within a few months, I'd stopped chiropractic because it didn't help me much. I stopped the sit-ups a bit later after straining my stomach muscles. In college, I finally dumped the lift for my left foot because it annoyed me, and I never looked back. Currently, my back pain is managed by me, an occasional gentle massage. Not that shoveling snow or overdoing running doesn't cause me pain. I encounter pain and resolve it. It doesn't linger or set up permanently in my body, because I use a wide variety of techniques to move beyond it. My experience is not uncommon. Over the last two decades, I've seen hundreds of backs. I've never seen a perfect spine, nor a perfect body. We all have our oddities that could explain any amount of pain, but one of the unspoken miracles of medicine is the number of people who should experience pain, but don't. On the other side is the nightmare of people who should be fine because there's nothing visibly wrong with them. But they are nagging.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.